The five solid principles of object-oriented design help us think about code in ways that increase its maintainability and extensibility. Without good design principles, software development slows, gets more expensive, and more frustrating as projects age. In this presentation, I will demonstrate each principle as a way to respond to design challenges in object-oriented code. In order to talk about object-oriented design, we first need to define it. In order to do that, I will briefly compare and contrast it with another popular programming paradigm. So the first thing I want to talk about in this presentation of object-oriented design is functional programming. Functional design, not surprisingly, utilizes functions that implement how a system changes state. Those functions may take arguments and then return data that implements the desired output of a program. Consider a lamp. Maybe there's one sitting next to you right now. You interact with a lamp by toggling a switch, turning it on or off. If we were to write a program to describe how a lamp works, it might look like this example. There is the data describing the current state of the lamp, and then two functions, one for turning the lamp on and the other to turn it off. In this example, our functions are only concerned with this on or off state. They use some features of JavaScript to make sure it doesn't lose any of the other data associated with the lamp, and then sets one property. It returns a copy of the lamp data as a sort of best practice to minimize the possibility of our code having side effects. Contrast that with an object-oriented example of that same lamp. We see the same data and the same commands, but the key difference here is that both the state of the program and its behavior are co-located inside a class. Switch on and switch off no longer take arguments, but modify the state property internally. Instead of talking about functions, we now say that the lamp class accepts switch on and switch off as messages, and the way it responds to those messages implements the behavior of the program. This idea of message passing is the identifying feature of object-oriented design. A class should have one purpose and therefore only one reason to change. The single responsibility principle challenges us to tend toward focused code that does one thing and does it well. Over the course of this presentation, we'll look at the client side of a web service implementation. We'll consider how to make the request, handle the response, and how the program must grow as the requirements change. This first example retrieves information about the user's profile. The client makes a request, parses the response, and creates a new instance of the profile upon receiving the single message, get. This program has a problem, though. Get takes an argument, the path to the remote endpoint. Since this path need not be to a profile, the decision to build a profile on line 13 is presumptive and likely incorrect. We can imagine that there are more endpoints than just this one for the profile, and we need to accommodate them. In light of that, the responsibility for creating the profile now seems separate from making requests to the remote system. We can move the responsibility for dealing with the response out of the client and into a new class. The client is now only responsible for communicating with the remote system, and the new web service profile mapper is responsible for turning that response into our profile. This incremental change has made it easier to introduce new endpoints to our program. We started with one class with all the necessary features to build the profile. Now we have two classes, each with a narrower scope than the original. Objects should be open for extension, but closed for modification. The open-close principle applies similarly to the single responsibility principle, but instead of looking closely at the thing to be changed, we now look at how other parts of the system can cause changes to be necessary elsewhere. Here's the code from the previous example after some time had passed, only in this scenario, the developer didn't create the mapper class. As it turns out, there were more endpoints, and now each time an endpoint is added, the client must be enhanced to support that endpoint. Since things outside of the client's control can require it to change, it has violated the open-closed principle. As a side note, long if-else blocks are frequently indicative of open-closed problems like what you see here. The fix here is slightly different. It doesn't need to be, but you'll see in later examples that the developer is anticipating other problems that the mapper approach wasn't well suited to address. Instead, each endpoint now has its own complete request implementation. We can ignore the specifics of how they work. What is important is that they can implement anything they must in order for the request to succeed. The entire request is passed in as an argument. Its path method returns that path which was previously passed in on its own. And its extract response method implements the logic for building the necessary object or objects from the response. Adding new endpoints no longer requires the client to change. As an added benefit, each new endpoint might be isolated enough to allow multiple developers to work on each one independently. Avoiding design errors like of this type can be a real productivity multiplier for a team. Every subclass should be substitutable for its parent class. Liskov substitution is something to think about every time you create a subclass. First described in a paper by Jeanette Wing and Barbara Liskov, it is the only topic in this list with a purely mathematical definition. Let theta x be a property provable about objects x of type t. Then theta y should be true for objects y of type s, where s is a subtype of type t. Got that? Great. Let's move on. Sometime later, it was decided to create a generic request class to enable some code reuse. Requests for the user's profile were different, though. Instead of being able to reuse extract response, it was necessary to override the parent implementation to gain access to the response object. Our conscientious developers versioned their API, and the impact of that versioning was thoughtfully accounted for in the client implementation. This change introduced a subtle error, though. At some point, the decision was made to log every response that the program received. It was implemented as a side effect of extracting the response. When profile request was implemented, the developer did not carry forward this detail, and now these responses will not be logged. Even worse is the likelihood that this omission very likely will not be discovered until there is a need to go searching through profile responses, only to discover there are no logs. The team could undertake a large refactor here. Side effects are undesirable in code. Maybe the team has time to do this, but there might be a simpler option. While not ideal, sometimes the best decision is to carry the side effects forward. By adding one line of code and checking anywhere else extract response was overridden, the team can quickly return to implementing valuable features rather than undertaking a large refactor on the spot. Add this refactor to your issues tracker, estimate it, and prioritize it. One day it may turn out to be a valuable exercise. Dependencies should not be forced on objects that do not use them. Interface segregation lets us isolate each piece of our application. Remember message passing? If we've done our job, then different parts of our program can pass messages around and not be concerned with how those messages are handled. Authentication has been added to this web service client. Probably important, seeing as how we were retrieving that personal profile information the whole time. But look carefully. Not every request requires authentication. The shared request implementation simply returns null for authentication. That null is driving this if statement above, and fetch is called differently if getAuthentication returns something other than null. This authentication feature is part of an interface that is not shared among all requests. Therefore, the client cannot disregard how the request implementation works. We can isolate authentication to specific requests by introducing a new type into our system. In this case, we've reused the browser web API request type, which exposes every aspect of a request to our request builders. The client must change, which is unfortunate, but the refactor here acknowledges that we did not fully understand the scope of the feature at the beginning. The extensiveness of this change illustrates how important interface segregation really is. Improperly defined interfaces can impact large portions of a code base. Objects must depend on abstractions rather than concretions. Dependency inversion ensures that specific implementations of the dependencies in your program can be easily interchanged. We finish with a much simpler example. This could be a convenience method somewhere in the app for retrieving profile information. It creates instances of the web service client and the request, then fires it off and should return an instance of profile. But how would you test this? This code is dependent on the real web service client. You probably don't want to make real requests when running tests. Not only is it inconvenient to depend on an application server, you also have very little control over test conditions. It would be difficult or impossible to induce specific failures. False negatives would occur anytime that test server went down. If your build process is gated by your test suite, and it should be, you wouldn't be able to deploy as long as that test server was offline. If this convenience method took the web service client as an argument, then anything that behaved like our client could stand in for it. Tests could use a fake implementation or a mocking framework to mimic the success and failure modes of the client. Is it a problem that we're using the real implementation of profile request? Maybe. The dependency inversion principle would lead us to pass this in as an argument too, but replacing it is more difficult since its constructor requires an argument. This might be another instance where this is the tip of a very large refactoring iceberg to do this perfectly. The ability to make incremental changes and be cognizant of diminishing returns beats perfect adherence to these principles. Let these five solid principles of object-oriented design be more like signposts than lane markers for your code. They guide you towards better implementations and help you better identify and respond to architecture problems. I thank you for watching.